At Bertram's Hotel is a 1965 novel by Agatha Christie. It's another Miss Marple, so we have two Miss Marples in a row. This is right after Caribbean Mystery. And as I was saying, the lack of a sense of place in Caribbean Mystery, I think, is more than made up for in this one, because Bertram's becomes kind of a character all its own in the novel. Bertram's is, of course, an old hotel in London, and Miss Marple goes there for 2 weeks. She's sent there by Raymond. And Bertram's is a hotel kind of the old Edwardian period. It was always known for its gentility, for its old way of doing things. And it seems to be this sort of relic of the past in modern London. So while everything's changing around it, Bertram's has maintained the same look and feel that it's had since Jane Marple visited there as a child back in presumably the 1880s or 1890s. She goes here, and she's quite impressed by the fact that it has withstood the test of time, that has been a constant amid all of this change. And in a way, the novel sets up Miss Marple and the hotel is set kind of a point of comparison and contrast. Both are old. Both hang on to old ways of doing things. However, while Bertram seems to have done very little changing besides modern conveniences and things that are kept quietly, you know, kind of hidden so that it maintains this old world look. Miss Marple, while she still may be old fashioned in many ways, has moved forward and recognizes that the world has changed. So she's a bit in awe of this. The other thing that she's in awe of is the fact that when she sees her friend Selina Hazy and they start talking, she notices that Selina is constantly recognizing people at Bertram's, and half the time she's incorrect about who she's recognizing. She's seeing an old vicar or a captain or a colonel or a businessman or someone that she knew from her past. Sometimes she's right, sometimes she's wrong. One of the people she's right about is a person who is completely incongruous with the hotel, Lady Bess Sedgwick, who is kind of an adventurous woman. She has had a string of husbands, moves from one adventure to the next, takes life by the horns, and is a very vivacious sort of woman. And we find out early on that Bess has a daughter, Elvira, I guess we'd say in America, and Elvira Blake doesn't know very much about her mother, Bess. She knows that Bess is her mother, but she's been kind of kept separate from her mother and has been brought up by relatives, and she's just returning from Italy where she was attending finishing school, which still feels a bit odd for the 1960s, but maybe that was still going on. So she returns. She's very concerned about her inheritance. She's very concerned about meeting her mother. Her mother does not want to meet her. She feels like that her daughter's better off without her. And Elvira is also morbidly concerned with what would happen to her money if she were to die. So she seems to have some, not really a fear of her death, but a fascination with her death and the inheritance. Family in this novel is another disjointed sort of thing. We have a mother, daughter, no father in the picture, at least not a biological father to speak of. Mother and daughter are separated, hardly know each other. They are both driven women, have desires and want to fulfill them, but whereas the book describes Bess as being very outwardly driven, she sees what she wants, she goes for it, no hesitation, whereas Elvira is a very kind of interior person. She's one of these girls that everyone thinks is just a quiet, polite girl, and underneath the surface, she's quietly kind of plotting to get her way. For example, we discover not far into the novel that she is having an affair with a race car driver of kind of a seedy character named Ladislav Malinowski. And we find out later in the novel that he's also having an affair with Elvira's mother. So this man's kind of working both the mother and the daughter. One of the interesting things about this disjointed family is the major father character is not someone related to either woman, but the police detective, Davey, who is affectionately known by his colleagues as father. And Christie goes back and forth between calling him father and Davey, and at first it may seem a bit confusing, and you're wondering, well, what's happening here? But it's kind of interesting, because another father character in the novel is Canon Pennyfather, who is an Anglican priest. He's an important character, not so much as a father figure, but as he's forgetful, and he becomes kind of the catalyst for the events that occur next, and he becomes the reason that Miss Marple begins to suspect that something was wrong, because he goes missing. Which isn't completely unusual, because this is a man who forgets everything. He's supposed to go to a biblical conference in Lucerne, and gets the airport and discovers that it was held the day before, so he's gone on the wrong date. He goes out to a restaurant and is not seen again. His maid becomes quite worried about him, and then the hotel is a bit worried because they don't know what to do with his baggage. So you have issues like this. At the same time, one of the major plot lines of the novel is the fact that there are a number of robberies, train robberies, bank robberies going on throughout the city of London and throughout England, and they seem to all be kind of emanating from a central group. So we've got this idea that there's this kind of a crime syndicate going on. So in that way, this novel is one of her more kind of like espionage or crime novels. Yet there is also a murder story attached to it as well. As far as this type of novel for Christie, usually she's not very successful at it. She was somewhat successful in the 1920s when she could get away with a bit more far-fetched, fantastic plotting with all these super criminals and masterminds and people trying to take over the world. This one, to me, of her later novels of this type is a bit more successful because it is just a crime syndicate, and it's possible to imagine a crime syndicate and this group using something legitimate as a front to cover their activity, which we see in numerous stories about the mafia and different things like this. So I didn't find it so far-fetched. But really, Christie's interweaving two different stories here. A murder story and this theft. And one throws light on the other and help. Davey, with the help of Miss Marple, is able to figure out what's going on. We don't get to see so much of Miss Marple's reasoning or logical thinking or village parallels. But what we do see is her discussion of just the atmosphere, that there's something not quite right about Bertram's. It's perfect. It's too perfect. There's a theatricality about it that she does not like. So in that regard, it's not so bad. I thought the denouement of the novel a bit abrupt. She does go for a different style of ending. It's not your traditional wrap-up of the murder case. And so it's interesting in that way, yet I think she could have done it over a bit longer period. It seemed like she just wanted to be done with the thing by the time she was on the last chapter. So for that reason, I probably give it maybe a... probably like a 3 out of 5, and that might be a generous 3. But she's... I didn't mind it as much as I thought I would. So what am I reviewing next? I'm not sure. But probably Third Girl. And we'll talk to you later.